Good day. My name is Joseph Arts. Most of you know me as a long-time volunteer and CDISC instructor. The usual disclaimer and an overview of what I will be talking about today. First, I will give a very short introduction about the use of real-world data and especially electronic health records in clinical research. An important use of electronic health records in clinical research is the selection of eligible subjects by comparing information in the EHRs, such as disease condition, age, procedures obtained, medications taken, against the eligibility criteria in the protocol. More and more, EHRs are also used to generate synthetic arms, for example as a placebo arm where it would be unethical to expose patients to placebo treatment, such as in cancer studies. One may even question whether providing people a placebo vaccination during a pandemic is ethical. And of course, collection of prior medications and medical history can be much more easy and accurate when the patient has an electronic health record that documents all these. An important breakthrough for enabling the use of electronic health records in clinical research has recently been made, the FHIR to CDISC project. People in this session, like Rhonda and Rebecca, may plead guilty here. The project was mostly executed by FHIR guru Lloyd McKenzie and his co-workers. It provides a mapping between FHIR resources and CDISC SETM domains and variables, especially using FHIRpath to describe the relations. The results were also published as XML, making it possible to use the FHIRpath relations in software, so automating a lot of things, and we have already started doing so in our own software projects. The results of the FHIR to CDISC project do, however, not solve the semantic interoperability problems. After all, healthcare uses very modern coding systems, such as Loinc, UQM, SNOMED CT and others, mostly pre-coordinated, whereas CDISC uses lists of codes and terms with little amount of explicit relations between them. As CDISC is not ready yet to use coding systems from healthcare, this unfortunately means that we need mappings. Developing such is, however, a lot of work. Now, CDISC did already a great job by publishing mappings between the most popular Loinc codes for lab tests, but this does not include microbiology tests, such as needed for COVID-19 studies, toxicology tests, vital signs tests, challenges, ECG, and so on. Therefore, we extended the CDISC mappings to over 20,000 mappings for over 10,000 Loinc codes, including COVID-19 microbiology tests, over 600 vital signs tests, and several thousands drug toxicology tests. We made these mappings available as a set of public RESTful web services, so anyone can use this in software applications. We also implemented the recently published SNOMED MEDRA mappings as a RESTful web service. This is especially important for adverse events and medical history, as healthcare doesn't use MEDRA at all. This RESTful web service is, however, not public due to licensing restrictions of both organizations. And of course, we also use the CDISC Library API and RESTful web services. These mappings will also be necessary for the Vulcan project to become successful. As the Vulcan project is about bridging the gaps between healthcare and clinical research, it also includes the implementation of and the development of new FHIR resources, such as for covering the schedule of activities. Furthermore, there is a sub-project on patient leaflets for which there is already the XML-SPL standard. OMOP alignment is of course also a very important topic. And the project I am involved in is the automated generation of SDTM datasets from EHR via resources. We do, however, not make very rapid progress in this project. Until now, only generation of demographics and prior and concomitant medications have been demonstrated. We can already do much more, however. As we do have all these LOINC mappings, we can use them to also automatically generate SDTM datasets for other domains, especially findings domains. So, we developed software to automatically generate SDTM datasets for DM, for CM and MH, and describe the relations between them in a Relvec dataset, and for the findings domains LB, VS and COVID-19 MB. We recently could also add AE using the SNOMED-MEDRA mapping and also add additional records to Relvec for describing the relations between AE and CM. The software is written in Java and is available as open source. I will provide the link at the end of the presentation. And we are testing using publicly available FHIR repositories such as HappyFHIR and CynTIA. Okay, let's do a demo. First, we select the EHR system and the server it resides on. For testing purposes, we have a number of public FHIR test servers available. I select the COVID-19 test server. The system then asks me whether I would like to select the subjects from a FHIR research study or based on a disease by its SNOMED CT code. The FHIR research study resource can be seen as an electronic protocol. I select to go for a research study and then provide the location of the research study. This can be on another system as where the data resides. The system then retrieves the subjects as research subject resources. The user is then asked whether all observations for these subjects should be taken into account, or coming from a set of LOIN codes, for example, coming from the new FHIR resources, activity definition and observation definition. I select all observations. The system then retrieves all observations for the subjects. Each observation is categorized into an SDTM findings domain and the SDTM datasets and records are generated. It is then asked whether I want to standardize quantitative results to either SI or to US conventional units for STRESC and STRESN variables. This is possible by virtue of the combination of using UCOM notation for the units with the LOIN code and uses a RESTful web service from the US National Library of Medicine. This is impossible when using CDISC units. I select to standardize to SI units. Similarly, for vital signs, we can standardize to metric units if desired. Then the DM dataset is generated. The system then asks me whether I want to generate a medical history dataset. If so, it will be generated from FHIR condition resources. I say yes. Similarly, it asks me whether I want to generate a prior and concomitant medications dataset. Also here, I say yes. The system then generates the CM dataset from a set of different medications resources. One also sees reason for medication passing by. These can be used to create a Relrec between CM and MH. At the end, an overview of all the generated datasets is provided, including supplemental qualifier datasets. If we can retrieve information from FHIR EHRs for generating submission datasets, This raises the question whether FHIR could be used as a regulatory submission standard in future. HL7 has already developed a good number of new resources for use in clinical research. FHIR has a lot of advantages for the regulatory submission use case. Submission data need not to be aggregated in files, it can just be remote and distributed. Reason for this is that FHIR has a very nice API and provides RESTful web services, so there is no need for using transport files anymore. This allows for real rolling data review and not in batches as is now usual. Furthermore, FHIR uses modern formats such as XML, JSON and RDF, which are ideal for use in RESTful web services. It is pretty hard, if even possible, to use SAS Transport 5 with RESTful web services. And, last but not least, when using FHIR, there is much more clear separation between source data and derived data. We should not forget that SDTM is a mixture of both, and in submissions, it is not always clear what is collected and what is derived. However, regulatory reviewers are not at all ready to work with FHIR, let it be with APIs and RESTful web services. They are used to only work with tables originating from files. Also, there are no regulatory review tools for FHIR yet. Reviewers are used to work with the by the sponsors pre-cooked derived data, like the DDY variables. They seem not to be capable to derive such data themselves. Starting working with FHIR would require the regulatory authorities to considerably modernize their IT infrastructure. But can't we have best of both worlds? We do know that regulatory reviewers are interested in seeing the source data, but this is barely possible with the current SDTM and especially with the still mandated SAS Transport 5 format. So, for the case the source is an EHR using FHIR, we had the idea, why not embed the source FHIR resource within the result SDTM record? This is very easy when using a modern format such as XML or JSON instead of SAS Transport 5. In first instance, we decided to use CDISC's own dataset XML standard format to generate the SDTM datasets, as it is extensible. So, for each SDTM record in dataset XML format, we embedded the source FHIR record using its XML representation. In future, we will also try to do very similar using the new dataset JSON, which has the advantage of considerably smaller file sizes or message sizes when using an API and RESTful web services. This allows to transport SDTM datasets, including the real source records, either as files or using an API. Like this, we create a best of both worlds. For reviewers, they still see everything as familiar SDTM, but the source record is embedded and can easily be visualized by simple designated tools, such as the open source Smart Submission Dataset Viewer. When using this viewer, the narrative part of the FHIR source record is displayed as a tooltip when the user hovers the mouse over the Use Subject ID field of the SDTM record, together with other information such as demographic information. Much more is of course possible, creativity being the only limitation. Last but not least, here are a number of links to resources, our open source software, and the RESTful web services that we developed or used. And to the open source Smart Submission Dataset Viewer, to a number of demo movies that are available on YouTube, and to my blogs, where I regularly report my progress. Thank you, and I will be happy to answer questions.